So this is the end of the first chapter. This is really one or two concepts, key concepts, but not more than two mainly. We need to differentiate between the various types of ventilation. So we'll look at that. And then we have to understand what this dead space stuff is. It's very important, okay? So this lecture basically focuses on two things, the various types of ventilations, okay? And the second part is dead space. What does it mean? Why is it important? Okay, so one part of ventilation, another part of the overview was, which part of the air that we take in is actually business air? What do I mean by business air? I.e. the air that actually participates in gas exchange, that is beneficial for us, the whole point of the lung. And which part of the air does not do that? So today you will hopefully understand that whenever you take air in at whatever rate, a part of that air is beneficial in terms of gas exchange, while another part of it, not so much, okay? Okay, so pulmonary versus alveolar ventilation. It's a very basic concept, but sometimes it may be in a viva, you can get confused. Pulmonary means always. Pulmonary would mean the whole lung, the whole thing. So pulmonary ventilation is the total amount of air that you are taking in inside your lungs, both of the lungs, at whatever unit volume there is. Usually it's per minute. So the total amount of air that you're taking in per minute inside your lungs is called pulmonary ventilation, right? Part of that air goes into the gas exchange areas. Remember in the first lecture we studied, there's a conducting zone and then there is a respiratory zone. Deep inside there is a respiratory zone, while the initial parts of the respiratory whole system is the conducting zone. The conducting zone does not take part in gas exchange. This does, okay? So the total amount of air when you take it in, part of that air goes into the gas exchange areas. That ventilation is alveolar ventilation. So of the total pulmonary ventilation, a part is alveolar ventilation. It is this part that is beneficial in the sense of gas exchange. What about the rest? What about the part which stays in the conducting zone? That is referred to as dead space. So now we are introducing slowly the concept of dead space, okay? This is that. Okay. So imagine that you have just done an expiration and now you have paused it. A normal tidal volume expiration has been done. How much is tidal volume? 500 ml. So you inspired air, expired, and just pause it here. Don't stop breathing. Conceptually pause it. What remains in the lung? Which capacity remains in the lung? FRC. Who said that? Yes. The functional residual capacity. If I had said you, not tidal volume, but if I had said that you expire to your maximum, then what would have been left? Residual volume. Okay, so you have a hang of the volumes and capacities. Good. But I said tidal volume. So normal breath, expire and pause. At the level of alveoli, what is there? There is still air there, right? Of the FRC. But at the level of alveoli, theoretically speaking, if this was that alveolus, that little chunk of air that still stays there is this block, this yellow block. You understand this? This is the FRC, the part of the big FRC, the part where is occupying this one alveolus, theoretically speaking, okay? So that the thing doesn't collapse. We've done that. Now on top of this yellow block, conceptual, you inspire the next tidal volume. So if the tidal volume is this 500 ml, okay, and this is your 500 ml. For now, just ignore the values. This is that 500 ml, okay? This is the air that goes in first. Obviously, when you suck it, the air goes in, the initial molecules go in first, then the molecules that come afterwards, and then the tail end of the molecules, okay? If we construct this here, this yellow block is now pushed inside because you have taken a fresh tidal volume air in, okay? So this is here, like this, okay? This tidal volume air, 500 ml, is here, like this. From the gas exchange point of view, which part of 1, 2, and 3 type of airs that now occupy your lung will be beneficial from the gas exchange point of view? Would it be the stale air from the previous breath? Obviously not, because all the stuff has been taken out and extra stuff has been put into it. It was supposed to be eradicated. It was supposed to go out. However, remember the balance that you have, the compromise that you have to keep stale air in so that it doesn't collapse and all that sort of stuff. However, the big chunk of the new inspiration air, about 350 ml, that is fresh, you've just inhaled it. This is the air that actually goes into play in gas exchange. What about the tail? The tail, about 150 ml of fresh air, does not. That is the dead space. So the tidal volume air that remains, that can't reach the gas exchange areas by virtue of it coming late, it being the tail end of the tidal volume, it is stuck. It is stuck in the conducting zone. Hence, although it's fresh, it can do everything that the alveolar air can, but it's just that the geography is not right for gas exchange, right? So that air will not participate, cannot participate, and we are okay with that. The conducting zone air does not, cannot participate in gas exchange. Its value is normally 150 ml. Log that away. Important piece of information. So out of the tidal volume of 500, 150 is out, 350 is operational as far as gas exchange is concerned. This dead space, the concept, is by virtue of the anatomy. What are the conducting zones? The mouth, the nose, upper airways, then the trachea, the principal bronchi, right to the level of, who remembers the milestone where the respiratory zone starts? 16th division, name of the segment. Terminal bronchiole. The Betaji, before terminal bronchiole to this area, the whole thing is conducting zone. That whole thing is anatomical dead space. New information. Air that occupies the conducting zone is anatomical dead space air. Air that occupies terminal bronchiole till alveoli is the alveolar air ready for gas exchange.
Question, hard question, can be questioned in a viva with the good ones. What if, and this if is not theoretical, sometimes we need this sample. What if you need a sample of the alveolar air? How would you get it? What maneuver would you do to get this?
Deep expiration.
Deep expiration and?
Last major alveolar.
Perfect. So you will ask the patient to expire, to take air out during expiration, and you're not interested in the initial molecules.
Why aren't you interested in the initial molecules? Because they are coming from the dead space. So what went in like this, this part was, went into the alveoli, this part remained in the conducting zone. When you expire, it comes out like this. So the initial part is dead space, fresh air. The used up depleted air comes at the end, okay, a little, because rest is left, right? This is why this diagram is actually very nice. It actually shows you in squares what is where and color codes it. It's very nice, not in Guyton, by the way. So if you have to sample alveolar air, you would like to take a sample from the end of a normal expiration. That's where the alveolar air will be represented a bit. You're looking slide, don't worry about it. This is the nitrogen washout method for estimating dead air, dead space. So of course you'd be curious, or maybe not in your case, where did the 150 ml came from? How did we estimate that? It's actually very easy. This is that method. It's given in guidance, so you need to know. Nitrogen washout or Fowler's method, okay? What do we do? Again, the good old spirometer. But this time, we connected with 100% pure oxygen cylinder. So the guy, you sit the person whose dead space needs to be estimated. You connect the whole setup. And now, at the start of the test, you ask him to inhale from the spirometer. Now the spirometer is connected with 100% pure oxygen. What is the percentage of oxygen in the atmosphere?
Where was I? So we were doing the experiment. So 100% oxygen this guy inhales. Now think in terms of the tidal volume squares that you have just read. What happens? When he inhales 500 ml tidal volume of pure, 100% pure oxygen. There is nothing else in this oxygen. Yes? The thing goes in. The initial 350 ml goes where? To the respiratory zone, the alveoli. And the conducting zone occupies 150 ml. What happens with the 350 ml? It mixes with the yellow box, the stale air of the previous breath. So it depurifies, the oxygen concentration drops. And guess what is in the stale air that is in the highest amount? Nitrogen. Nitrogen. The air that we breathe in has 71% nitrogen, right? So nitrogen is overrepresented in the atmosphere and hence in the breaths as well. So that stale air that's sitting in there is actually less in oxygen, further less in oxygen, because we took it out, remember. But it's high in nitrogen and it's just sitting there. And here there's a brand new breath with 100% oxygen coming in. So it pollutes the 350 ml with nitrogen. Right? You understand? However, it cannot reach the conducting zone where you have 100% oxygen sitting by virtue of the whole setup. This is one part of the experiment. You understand this? Now, very simply, you ask the guy to exhale. But during expiration, all you need to do is connect the spirometer mouthpiece with a nitrogen detector. You see the plan now? initially, it will it detect any nitrogen?
No, sir.
It won't. It won't. This graph is of nitrogen. Nitrogen washout. So initially, no nitrogen will be detected because the dead space occupies 100% oxygen. You gave it to him, right? That part will be reflected in this graph. And from that part, you can calculate. And as soon as the nitrogen comes up, you calculate the area under the curve and outside the curve. You probably have read these terms in mathematics. The area under the curve, and then there's the area outside the curve. From these two areas, you calculate exactly where the oxygen, 100% oxygen coming out stopped and nitrogen started to come in. That is the point of the dead space. That's how dead space is calculated. If there are no questions, let me put in one clinical bit now, which will come in very handy in the next week series of lectures. By the way, dead space are of two types. The normal, fixed, anatomical dead space present in everyone. And then there is a bad dead space. Dead space is bad anyway, and anatomical dead space is also bad from the gas exchange point of view because it doesn't give us anything really. But that's it. The other dead space, it's called physiological dead space. Now this physiological dead space is, mark these words, are the areas where gas exchange is not happening in this particular lung in addition to the anatomical dead space. Bad. Why bad? Because the lung respiratory zone should be open for business all the time, depending on your activity, of course. When you go into exercise, everything opens. But when you are at rest, just enough stuff opens to accommodate your tidal volumes, enough for tidal volumes, and the whole thing goes into gas exchange. However, in patients with structural damage of the lung, hint, hint, there are areas, no-go areas, like these crosses, no-go areas where even if you were to ventilate them, there's no point of ventilation because there's no blood supply, because the whole thing is broken. Broken. Hint, hint. So the blood vessels were part of the architecture of the whole tree. What if they are broken or messed up? So the air will go, but there is nothing to exchange with because there is no blood supply there. While it should have. This area, while it's not part of the anatomical dead space, constitutes the physiological dead space. This is abnormal, not good. So in a patient, and there are if the total dead space in your patient comes out to be more than 150 ml, know that this guy has something wrong in him. There are areas of the normal healthy lung which are not participating in gas exchange because he has a physiological dead space, not just anatomical dead space. So anything above 150 ml should be investigated, and it's a problem. Okay. This should be the second last slide. Very simply put, look at this minute ventilation, alveolar ventilation. Okay. So the total amount of air you breathe in, total, is called the ventilation rate. Ventilation rates are of two categories. One is the minute ventilation, and the other one is the alveolar ventilation. The minute ventilation is, in simple words, the total amount of air that you take in into the lung system per minute. Very simple. How do you derive it? You multiply tidal volume by respiratory rate. Normal respiratory rate is 12. At rest, generally speaking, average human being breathes 12 times in a minute. So if you're breathing 12 times in a minute, each breath is tidal air, tidal volume. You just multiply 12, multiply it by 500. Simple equation, very simple. This can come in your MCQs, okay? So we can ask you to calculate minute ventilation. Of course, not telling you that this is minute ventilation. We'll give you a scenario which will require you to have this knowledge. So 6 liters per minute, please remember, is the total ventilation, total air per minute that the lungs are accommodating, dealing with at rest. At rest is very important. So 6 liters of air you breathe in and out per minute right now, to give you some context. Now, how much of that 6 liters is actually going to the respiratory zones for gas exchange? This right here, I'm sorry, this really goes down, 4200 ml per minute. So the perceptive students will make a note of this, mental note, prefer. Out of 6,000, 4200 ml per minute air goes into gas exchange. The rest per minute is wasted in the anatomical dead space, considering of course that the guy is normal. So out of 6,000, remember 6,000, take it, 4200 is the beneficial gas exchange hitting air. Questions? This is pretty straightforward. Let's see a cool thing now. The cool thing has to wait. Yes. This is the last slide. You're off after this. Check this out. What's happening here? So normal quiet breathing at rest, this actually gives you a lot of information in a very easy to understand format. Tidal volume of normal quiet breathing is 500, we know that. Respiratory rate is 12, we know that. Dead space one is normally 150 ml, we know that. You calculate pulmonary ventilation or minute ventilation is 6000, we just did it. Out of which alveolar air is 4200, we know this. Now, the effect of breathing, how you breathe your air, is depicted here. It's actually very important. So people who don't breathe properly actually are living an unhealthy lifestyle. So look at the shallow one first, not the deep slow, which is the good one. Look at the shallow rapid breathing. So this guy, look at the tidal volume, not 500, 150 ml. So shallow breathing, any quick breathing, rapid rate, but each breath is little, it's carrying little volume. How dangerous this can be? It's this dangerous. So the off-throwing part of this all is, pulmonary ventilation is the same in all three scenarios. 6,000. So Kaneko, you're taking in and out 6,000 ml per minute, but if you are not breathing properly, you are breathing shallow, rapid, then you are literally doing no gas exchange, because alveoli is not receiving any volume of air. Why? Because of the rate is high, but the tidal volume is low. Replace that in your mind with high respiratory rate and good tidal volume. So in an athlete or you, one of you exercising, the respiratory rate will obviously go up. That's not the bad thing. Bad thing is shallowness of the breath, not rapid rate. Rapid rate is fine. When you exercise, you need to increase your rate of respiration. But it's the amount of air with each breath, that's the problem. So the word shallow is the problem word. Okay. In exercise, the respiratory rate goes up, and the tidal volume is the same. You can imagine that pulmonary ventilation goes through the roof, and so does the alveolar ventilation in exercise, normal case, right? Now, deep slow breathing, check it out. In deep slow breathing, you have, because it's deep, you really stretch it, like in certain yoga or relaxation meditation procedures, where you're asked to take a deep breath. That deep breath is tidal volume air. Now you know. So the deep breath, even if the respiratory rate is less than half, can give you an alveolar ventilation of better than at rest. Okay? This will put, the reason I discuss this always, again, not in guidance, is because it puts minute ventilation, alveolar ventilation, dead space, and gas exchange areas all in one place of context, one place of where you can relate with all this information in your daily lives. Normal breathing, deep breathing, shallow breathing, breathing in exercise. All of it's covered. The importance of alveolar ventilation is highlighted. Look, what is pulmonary ventilation? Pulmonary ventilation, जो बेटे minute ventilation ही पढ़ा अभी हमने. This minute ventilation is pulmonary ventilation. So you multiply tidal volume with respiratory rate. Simple. So it's 6,000 all of it because we are increasing one but decreasing the other, changing the other. When it's normal, then it gives 6,000. But when you increase one so much, okay, but decrease the other, it balances out. Still remains 6,000. So this is actually the trick. You have pointed out the right thing. The emphasis here. The total amount of air entering and leaving lung is the same. However, look at the bad stuff that's happening with the shallow rapid breathing scenario. Okay. Any other questions? G. Better look. It's good. It's a good scenario. What is a practical, real-life scenario of this? When can this happen to a medical student? Before a viva. Famous example. Before a viva, shallow, rapid respiratory rate. And you can now imagine that at that time, you're not helping yourself. It's a good point, actually. You're not helping yourself. You're not ventilating the gas exchange areas properly. There is a little bit that it's not very long to any cause any serious issue with gas exchange. Usually, what, half an hour before the viva, you go into this state, and then viva happens, and then you say, well, this wasn't a big deal, and then you come out. So, and mashallah, you're young, and you don't have any, as you said, structural damage to the lungs. So, you, assuming you have normal lungs, this can be adjusted by the normal healthy body. The normal healthy body is a very tough machine. If you want to dent it, you need to really try very hard. The second part of the question was switching from shallow to deep. Well, that's a decision, isn't it? Because respiratory drive, while it's automatic, it also is under conscious control. So you tell the guy or the girl, okay, no, calm down, it's not the end of the world, and take deep breath. And try to ask the person to lean a bit forward because that promotes air entry into the lung. So if the person leans forward a bit and pull, it's like this. This is better, right, as compared to absolutely straight. This is difficult, especially when a person is hyperventilating. Please remind me that when we cover control regulation or regulation of control of breathing, we will discuss this scenario again. But with a different twist. I'll just give you the key word that a person who is hyperventilating like this can actually go into an acid base problem. No? Ever heard of it? So, have you ever heard that somebody was breathing so hard, so shallow and hard, that they fainted afterwards? This happens a lot. You get a very bad news, or you're super anxious, you're, and you don't control your ventilation. It goes up, and you faint in a few minutes. Okay, that fainting is explained by an acid-base disorder that happens due to hyperventilation of the individual. What could possibly be that acid-base disorder? Could it be acidosis or alkalosis? Remember, you are hyperventilating. It's alkalosis. Why? Because you're breathing out carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is volatile acid. So when you are abnormally high respiratory rate, you're on that, you are abnormally releasing more carbon dioxide than you should. That depletes the acids in the body and puts the person into respiratory alkalosis. Respiratory alkalosis or alkalosis itself is depressing on the neurons. It depresses neurons. Faint.